All right, here we go. Do you want to burn fat fast and not lose muscle? Well, one of the best ways to do it is with high-intensity interval training. But hold on, hold on. Don't leave just yet. You're probably doing it wrong. Everybody does it wrong. So in today's episode, we talk all about the ways to do it right, the reasons why a lot of people do it wrong. Also, I'm giving away our version of HIIT training, MAPS HIIT. Now, of course, this is HIIT training done right because we wrote it and we know what we're doing. So here's how you can win free access to MAPS HIIT. Leave a comment below in the first 24 hours that we drop this episode. Subscribe to this channel and turn on your notifications. Got to do all those things. If we like your comment, we'll notify you and you'll get free access to MAPS HIIT. Also, we're going to do a sale on MAPS HIIT because that's what we talk about in today's episode. So we're going to put it as 50% off. It's a very short sale. We'll do it maybe for a little while, but it will end. So it's 50% off MAPS HIIT. Here's how you can get that half off. Go to mapshit.com. That's M-A-P-S-H-I-I-T.com. And then use the code, let's see here. Oh, there it is. HIIT2022. So HIIT2022 for that 50% off discount. So there you go. Enjoy the show. Hey, you know, every year in January, I like to look up like what they predict are going to be the new fitness trends or whatever.
Mm-hmm.
Do you guys want to guess what's on there? It's been on there probably for the last 5 years as the next, you know, big fitness trend, or here's where we're going to see lots of growth and excitement. You guys want to guess?
Yeah. Has it changed at all, or is it the same exact thing?
There's one thing.
Okay. Skip it.
In particular. What?
Skip it.
What's that?
Skip it. You guys don't remember Skip It?
Skip it.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah.
That was brilliant.
I remember that. Yeah.
I don't know why they haven't brought that back, dude.
I don't know.
Great. Have you ever tried it?
Huh?
You ever tried it?
No, it was legit.
Did you like it?
Yeah, I loved it as a kid.
No.
I remember.
You didn't have a Skip It.
Yes, I did.
You made your own.
Skip it. Yeah,
we were poor.
It was a can and a fishing line.
Yeah. It was your other shoe. You tied your shoelace to it.
Yeah.
No.
Mom, mine doesn't work well. Yeah.
No, when your mom's like, we got to skip it at home. No. What I always see is HIIT training, high intensity interval training.
That's been on there for a long time.
Every year, it's always one of the top. It's like top two or three as fitness trends. And again, for 2022. It's like they're predicting it to be another huge fitness trend. So what do you guys think? I think because in my own head, I can think of many reasons why that may be true and also why that might not be so true. And we are in January, so this is when everybody's really looking up, you know, new ways to work out or whatever.
I mean, I think we learned this when we launched HIIT, 2 years ago or 3 years ago now? How long has it been, Doug? Three?
Probably at least three.
So 3 years ago when we launched it, it was like the fifth program or so that we launched. So we'd already done quite a few programs before it. And it was the largest launch that we've ever had. Mm-hmm. So, and for a long time, we actually talked about all the bad things around HIIT for a long time. So I didn't anticipate it to sell as well, but it still did. I just think that it's trendy because there are a lot of benefits too.
Yeah.
So it's not a trendy thing that's trash, right? Yeah. It's not the shake weight. It's not a bunch of bullshit. Yeah. Like there's tremendous value in HIIT training. And so I think the things that are compelling about it, right? Some of the benefits from HIIT is really compelling for a lot of people. And so I think it'll continue to be one of the hottest trends for quite some time.
I first heard about, because that kind of interval training had been around for a long time.
Mm-hmm.
But in the way that we talk about it now, I first started hearing about it in the early 2000s, and we've talked about this on the show, I don't know how many times, there were studies that came out showing how effective high-intensity interval training was in comparison to the traditional form of cardio, which was always steady state. So for people who don't know, steady state cardio is the kind that you're probably used to, where you get on a bike or a treadmill, and you're just going the same the whole time. HIIT training involves intervals of maximal, you know, intensity or exertion, followed by periods of, you know, rest, recovery type of deal, but not full rest like you would with traditional resistance training, but a slower pace. So it's like going hard, going easy, going hard. Now I'm oversimplifying it, but that's kind of the two things. That's kind of what separates them. Right?
I think it's popular because even like a lot of fitness, you know, people in the industry have been trying to figure out how to meet these consumer demands as they first come in. And, you know, it's a real tall task for the fitness professional to really draw up this long journey that it's really going to take, you know, in terms of having long-term success versus something that they could show them quickly that's going to benefit them. And, you know, HIIT is one of those type of methods that you can see benefit like pretty quickly from. Obviously, there's some things to consider that, you know, may not last very long, but this is something that could at least like jumpstart people.
Oh, that's an interesting theory. So your theory is that because it fits like the, you know, January narrative of get fit in 30 days or get shredded.
They're trying to kind of meet the demand of the hype.
I can get behind that. Yeah, I think that's an interesting
reason. It's got all the makings of great marketing. You know, great fitness marketing, like shorter time, it's hard, faster results.
Yeah,
you know?
It's fun,
right? Yeah, it's so here's something that I've communicated before. I think it's kind of interesting that, you know, cardio and resistance training, both forms of activity, both very different in terms of the adaptations. Cardio teaches your body to build more stamina and endurance, to become more efficient. It can cause metabolism to slow down. And when it's the only form of exercise in combination with diet, tends to result in a significant amount of muscle loss, and that's the body adapting to the cardio to get better at the cardio. Resistance training tells your body to build muscle, doesn't burn as many calories, but you get this metabolism boosting effect from it. Of course, body sculpting and strengthening and all that stuff. And so that's always been the comparison. Now, just using weights doesn't mean you're doing resistance training. I can take weights and I can turn it into steady state cardio, right? Mm-hmm. So I could take a pair of dumbbells and walk with them or do 500, 1,000 reps of an exercise, and I'm still doing like a cardio version of resistance training. Here's what's interesting about high intensity interval training done properly. It's it's almost like a resistance training form of cardio, right? So as weird as that sounds, it takes some of the effects of resistance training and it brings it over to a type of cardio. And primarily what it does is when you compare high intensity interval training to steady state cardio, when they're the sole form of exercise, that's important to say, because if you throw resistance training into a routine, then it negates a lot of the effects of even steady state cardio. But if it's just, if that's all you do, it's got a very profound muscle preserving effect. Right. So the fat loss in the studies on HIIT training is a higher percentage of the weight loss than you find in steady state cardio. So to put it more plainly, if you lost 10 pounds on the scale and steady state cardio was your primary form of cardio, 5 of it could come from muscle. Whereas from HIIT, maybe none of it comes from muscle, right? Almost all body fat. That's a very, very good pro.
It's still providing that signal to your body that you have to consider load and you have to consider strength as being something that is necessary by, you know, incorporating that but by doing it in a form like a type of a cardiovascular pace, you do receive some of those benefits, you know, the cardiovascular benefits from it as well. So it's kind of an interesting hybrid in terms of like, both of those different methods.
It's like, it's not the best of both worlds, but you get the benefits from both worlds.
Yeah, you get some of the benefits.
Right.
Of
both. So you're getting this the cardiovascular endurance, right? The strengthening of your heart from the repetitions being so high, the low rest periods, and so the heart's getting strengthened by doing that. But because you're actually weight training, you're also getting some of the strength benefits. But again, I also think that it's not the best of both worlds. It's just benefits from both worlds, because them by themselves, I think, are superior.
Well, for the right person whose goal is to be lean, have a good metabolism, maybe build some muscle, and they want to throw in some type of conditioning to improve their cardiovascular stamina and endurance, their VO2 max, maybe burn more body fat in a short period of time. It's for the right person, it's a great form of exercise because it's muscle preserving. Whereas other forms of cardio, you have to be very careful, because if you do too much of them, you start to send competing signals with resistance training, because it's the adaptation required or how it causes your body to adapt isn't going to work as well with resistance training, because it's trying to make you more smaller, burn less calories, more efficient metabolism, less muscle. Whereas with HIIT training, there's more of an anaerobic component. So for people who don't know what that means, right, there's aerobic, which literally means with oxygen. Anaerobic means without oxygen. Aerobic activity would be running for 5 miles at a steady state, right? Anaerobic form of running would be a short sprint.
Yeah.
You're running for short distance, really fast and explosively.
High intensity bouts.
Yes. And if you look at the, if you look at sprinters versus long distance runners, that's kind of a stark comparison, but it's a clear example of the difference of the types of bodies that anaerobic versus aerobic will build, right? Long distance runners are smaller, skinnier, less muscle. Sprinters, yeah, also lean, but way more muscle, way more muscular, way more
explosive.
Well,
they need to produce more force.
Yes.
And you know, when your body gets that signal that you need to produce more force, you know, you need to make sure that you have the muscle mass to be able to generate it.
Totally. Do you think it's the load or the rest periods that's preserving the muscle, or the combination of both?
It's the short anaerobic exertion, explosive, because you could do it without load technically. Like sprinting and running long distance using the same load, my body.
Right.
But sprinting is anaerobic. I'm going as fast as I can for 50 yards or 100 yards, right? And that requires big. It's okay, if you want your car,
so do you think
to drive 0-60 fast, you want a big engine, right? You want to go 600 miles, you need a small engine.
So do you think it's the actual sprinting part of it and the explosiveness of that, or the resting and recovering and allowing the heart rate to
both.
Come back down?
It's mm-hmm. both.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's got to be both, because if sprinting for 10 miles is no longer sprinting.
And I imagine this is a spectrum too when you talk about load, rest periods, totally. Explosiveness, that like there's a better way of doing this, totally. And then there's a less effective way of doing this based off of how close totally. You're leaning to more anaerobic versus how close you're leaning towards aerobic.
Yeah. Now, mm-hmm. one of the other challenges with steady state cardio is like what we're talking about, was just kind of this metabolic adaptation, which happens kind of quickly. Like if let's say you restrict your calories because you want to lose weight, so you cut your calories, and then you're doing lots of traditional steady state cardio. Your metabolism starts to adapt to meet the new demands, meaning it actually will slow down. And part of the way it slows down is it reduces muscle mass. We said that earlier, but that metabolic adaptation is a real thing. So for anybody watching or listening to this who's ever lost weight with that method, which is most people when they try to lose weight, that's the approach. What they'll notice is this weight loss that's initial, and then they start to hit this plateau, like what's going on? And then to get it to move even further, oh my God, I got to do more cardio, or I got to cut my calories even more. And then they get more results, and then it plateaus again. And it's called metabolic adaptation. And each time you go down, your metabolism adapts to that and makes it more challenging. You get far less of that with high intensity interval training, because HIIT training is also sending a signal that says we need strength and power. And in order to have strength and power, you need to have muscle. And so you get less of that metabolic adaptation. And there are studies that show that, comparing HIIT to steady state, where the metabolic adaptation is not, you know, not nearly as bad.
Well, and because of the intensity too, you're burning more calories too in a shorter period of time.
Yeah, that's the big selling point, right? Yeah. It's like, 15 minutes of HIIT training will burn as many calories as 30 minutes of steady state, right?
Yeah. And that's again meeting consumer demand, because everybody's a busy person. I have no time. Like, that is the number one excuse for the majority of people that come to the gym. I just don't have the time, you know, because it always seems like it has to be an hour or more, yep. you know, that they devote towards, you know, physical activity.
Yeah. So people would rather go really hard for 15 minutes than be stuck for 45 minutes. Doing something. So that's a huge selling point. And I get it. Look, I get it. I think, especially if you're doing other modalities of exercise and you're trying to add an extra calorie burn, you're looking at your schedule, you're like, I'm already working out for an hour. Like, I don't want to add another 40 minutes of exercise. Like, can I do this in a more effective way, or at least more efficient in terms of time? And HIIT training does that. And that's the biggest selling point. That was when those were some of the first studies I saw. Mm-hmm. Were like, it has the same effects with half the time. Yeah. Well, when trainers and clients saw that, I remember in the gyms, it was like all of a sudden overnight, people stopped doing traditional cardio and everybody started doing HIIT training. And that was the reason why it sold itself.
Well, I think the other reason is because the results come fast too.
Very quick.
Mm-hmm. Because when you are training that intensely right out the gates, your body's burning a ton of calories, and the calorie deficit that you're probably creating by doing that results in you dropping body fat or dropping weight relatively quick in comparison to a more traditional slow pace type of training. Yeah. And so I think that was the big selling point that I remember seeing a lot of, is the how quick you could transform and change the body.
Yeah, I could, for me personally, I could drop, and I want to be clear, when we say that it gives you faster results, it's not like, there's no miracles with exercise at all, right? So it's not fast results like you lose 30 pounds in a week. It's really crazy. It doesn't work that way. But I could drop, if I wanted to drop a couple percent body fat and I wanted to do it in a few weeks and I wanted to do it through exercise, not just through diet, HIIT training will do that very quickly for me. It's like within 3 weeks, I could drop 2 or 3% body fat through HIIT training. Other forms of exercise, not really. I would have to really be more stringent with my diet in order to do that. But with HIIT training, I could do a little bit of diet, HIIT training, and I'd see fast, you know, fat loss.
Well, especially if you have a good foundation to work with.
And totally.
It's something that, like, you could just interrupt your normal strength training and, you know, power out some HIIT training for a few weeks. It really has a significant impact on your body fat.
Yeah, I know it's not sold this way, but I like to use it as an interrupting my normal training, or on the times when I don't have the time, because it's designed to be a short 15 to 30 minute type of a routine. Well, there's times in my life when I only have 15 or 30 minutes. And to me, I find that's the best time to insert this versus me getting stuck in this HIIT training all the time. So I like to do that. Or if I've been on this kind of, you know, traditional strength training, you know, straight sets, long rest period. Yeah. I've been running a, you know, program after program that looks similar to that. Here, this is a great way to interrupt that and then go back to training that way. That's personally how I like to use it versus like following straight through for 6 to 8 weeks of HIIT training.
No, I'm with you with that. You know, and all the stuff that we just said, I think is probably why it stays at the top of fitness trends and why people, you know, gravitate towards it. Because those are pretty damn good selling points. Like if I was a consumer. Yeah.
Fast results, short amount of time,
you know,
fun.
Less muscle loss, like you don't slow your metabolism. Right, so if I was a consumer and I didn't know fitness like I know now, mm-hmm. I would be like, I'm doing that. That's what I
want
to do.
That's what I want right now.
Now here's the problem, and this is just, there's actually more than one problem, but here's the big one for me, is there's a high rate of injury and it's simply not appropriate for a lot of people. Like if
the majority, I would say.
I was just gonna say, like you know, I trained people one on one, and then I managed gyms, and I had trainers that trained people under me, and I trained the trainer. So either directly or by proxy, you're talking about hundreds or maybe 1,000 clients, right? One way or another. And you know, ask me what percentage of those people I would say HIIT training was appropriate for, right? Very small, 10%.
Yeah, I'd say about 10
at the most.
That's a good number.
Now the truth is, probably 90% of them were put on HIIT training by other trainers and stuff. Mm-hmm. When I knew what I was doing, I didn't have almost any of my clients do HIIT training. And that's because if you can't do something slow and controlled, the worst possible thing you could do is do it fast.
Speed it up.
Yeah, that's like taking something that's hard with a risk injury, an injury risk of 5, and now let's go fast. Well, now we've just made it, you know, a 20 with the risk of injury. But that's not it, right? There's also the high stress it places on the body. 15 minutes of HIIT is more stressful on your body than 40 minutes of low intensity cardio. It's just bottom line.
Well, like, it calls for high intensity.
It does.
I mean, and
even though the time is shorter, right?
Right, right. No, I think, and part of it too, I think that it's worse too, because when you see people doing it in the gym, it's applied incorrectly. Like you,
oh, that's a big one.
Rarely ever do I see, I feel, the right people doing it. You know, you see somebody who's a beginner, mm-hmm. who wants to lose, you know, 30, 40, 50 pounds, and the trainer's got them in this like circuit style with plyos and things in there. And it's just, that's the wrong client at the wrong time in their training phase to be doing something like this. Like there's so many other prerequisites that client should be doing before they even consider doing something like HIIT. And so that's the biggest bone I have to pick with HIIT training, is the people I see doing it are normally not the people that should be doing it.
And it's just so heavily motivated by fatigue, like how you know, quickly we can get you to fatigue. And then my biggest bone is that the form and you know, the way that these clients are performing the exercise just gets thrown to the wayside because at least they're moving. At least they're, you know, getting to that state where they're so fatigued that they could barely even move their body to, yep. to endure through the workout. And this becomes sort of that badge of honor thing and that martyr kind of syndrome around it where, you know, the client feels like they're making progress because they just go to the gym, they get beat up and they feel like just sweating that amount, like, you know, move them forward towards their goal when in fact it's probably deterring them significantly from their goal.
Yeah. So first off, even if it was, you could move properly. Okay. Let's say you live a high stress life or your sleep is off, or you're doing a lot of other workouts. And so you're pushing your body. It's also not appropriate because it's less restorative than steady state cardio. So steady state cardio, like I could have most people go for a 30-minute walk, however deconditioned they are. We could walk comfortably, slow, and that's a form of steady-state cardio. I could not take anybody, most people, and have them do just 7 minutes of real high-intensity interval yeah. training. It's just too much tax on the body. Not only that, but Justin, you were talking about, you know, how we value the fatigue and the intensity. It's all about fatigue and intensity and at all costs, meaning – you know, here we have a form of exercise that's where intensity's in the name. That's part of its value. It's part of the reason why it produces the results that it does and why it can be valuable. But we forget that form, technique, and control have to be present because without those.
Yeah, even in that setting.
Especially.
Yeah, especially in that setting.
Especially in that setting. Like to give another example, right? If you look at all the traditional exercises that exist, they all have a risk versus reward on them, right? Some exercises, very low risk. Like if you do a dumbbell curl, your risk of injury is way lower than if you do an Olympic clean, right? An Olympic clean is super technical. So what happens if I take someone with a dumbbell curl and I make them go until they can't move anymore? Well, the risk of injury goes up a little bit, but it's not nearly as high as if I take that person and have them do Olympic cleans.
Yeah, or jump boxes.
Or yeah, right? Because there's so much involved. And so a big problem that I have with almost every HIIT program I've ever seen in my entire life, and by the way, when we did ours, we placed a heavy emphasis on this because this is what mm-hmm. we saw. Mm-hmm. Nobody places any time at all or any programming on priming or mobility or connection or movement. So, which makes no sense to me because you're doing a form of exercise where the risk of injury is just higher, well, much higher. And you're not prioritizing
especially, that? Yeah, especially how high an impact it has on your joints and your ligaments and all the connective tissue and, you know, not even considering that by trying to do these restorative type of, you know, workouts in between to make sure that you still have good stability, function, control out of your joints to withstand a lot of this high impact. It's vital, in my opinion. And this is where some of these bad habits that you see with performing the exercises incorrectly or like through fatigue, they carry with clients. I'd have to like, you know, address those things later yep. on because, you know, when you're doing just regular strength phase, a lot of times some of these like habits of just trying to get through the exercise carries along with them.
You guys are also thinking like a bunch of old wise trainers.
Well, yeah.
Well, and I remember when we wrote this, it brought me back to, you know, when I used to write these types of workouts for clients in my early 20s and, you know, all the things that we were considering, you know, just a few years ago when we wrote this looked nothing like the things I was considering when I was writing it when I was 22.
Totally true.
And what I looked at had nothing to do with mobility or exercise selection as far as order of operation.
I didn't even know how hard and badass you could make it, right?
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. What I remember clearly, like I would put together these little HIIT circuits and the thought process was, okay, I need one or two hard ass compound, you know, type of movements that's going to get the heart rate going like crazy. And then I can do these other like auxiliary
lunge
movements.
Lunge to press.
Yeah. Like, do something that's hard yeah. to get the heart rate up and get it pumping so yep. that I know that they're going to be sweating and killing themselves on the other 4 to 5 exercises that I'm going to put with it. And that was the depth of thought that went into actually writing this. And I think that's what I still see today when I see clients training with trainers in the gym, doing these type of routines, I see one or two of these either plyometrics or compound or lunge to press to reverse curl, you know, type of movements, yeah. all, you know, 10 in one. And it's really designed just to get the client's heart rate pumping like crazy. And then their form goes to shit for the other four movements that follow.
Oh, the exercises are interchangeable and don't matter.
That's right.
There's no rhyme or reason.
Jump around and swing their arms.
Yeah, there's no rhyme or reason. You could do jumping jacks as hard as you want, as fast as you can, and you'll get the same benefit that you'll get from doing some of these workout programs, which is part of the reason why HIIT is so unsustainable. This is why I think it may not be a trend or an actual trend. I know they predict it to be a trend, but why it might not actually be a trend is because it's unsustainable for most people. People do it and they either burn out or they hurt themselves. And why? For the reasons that we're talking about. And so they get these results for 3 weeks, 4 weeks. Maybe they're lucky they can make it eight weeks. And then one of those things happens. I hurt my back. My knee's bothering me. Oh my God, I can't do any of these exercises anymore. Or
you just lose motivation.
Right? Because you're fried.
You're just fried and you're like, can I really come back to the gym and repeat this?
I also think that it's applied incorrectly a lot of times too, right? So it reminds me when I was teaching at Orange Theory. And at Orange Theory, you have like the cardio session and then you go over the weights. And these guys would go over to the weights. And, you know, up on the screen shows you the exercises and they're straight sets, but people get in this competitive circuit mindset of like trying to get through it. It turns into like, and it's just, it's almost like natural. It's not, maybe it's not even being coached by the trainers, but the client just knows I got to do this one, this one, this one, this one. And so they just go from exercise to exercise to exercise, never letting their heart rate come back down, and recover so then they can go all at it. So instead of it being like HIIT training is designed to go as hard as you can for a very short period of time and then recover. Hard as you can, then recover. There's none of that. It's just like this, I'm just going, trying to get through it as much as I can with no rest periods. And it looks more like cardio than it actually looks like weight training. And so I think part of the reason why it's not sustainable, they don't continue to see results from it, is because it's also being applied incorrectly.
Yeah, like the example I gave earlier, you could sprint for 50 yards and that would be considered anaerobic. That would be considered kind of HIIT. So like a sprint 50 yards and then walk back and then sprint, walk back type of deal, right? Or I could sprint for 5 miles. Now I'm going to be trying to sprint for 5 miles, but after I burn up my anaerobic energy, this is what happens to the body, it becomes aerobic. So it doesn't matter how hard I try to sprint. That's right.
The first 50 yards is effective. The other 4.5 miles.
That's right. And here's what's interesting about exercise in general, and you see this a lot with HIIT training. We tend to judge workouts by the effort or the exertion while we're doing it rather than the results. Now, I know we all say we want results, but it's very strange, right? Like if you see two people working out, now unless you're a educated trainer or experienced coach, I can look at two people and be like, oh, that person is working out smart. That person's working out effectively. And I can look at this person, that person's sweating and they're definitely breathing hard, but they're not working very effectively. Most people would look at those same two people and think
get them mixed up
and mix them up, right?
Yeah, yeah.
It's like this, right? It's like if I had a competition with two people and I said, dig me a 50-foot hole, and one guy uses his hands, the other person uses a big shovel, and me saying that the person with using their hands is doing a better job because they're working way harder. You would never say that. The person using the shovel is doing a better job because they're digging a deeper hole faster. If the goal is to get results, it's about doing it smart, not about doing it hard. Now, hard is part of the formula, but if that's not the only part of the formula, if it's the only part of the formula, then you're not going to get results. You're going to hurt yourself. It's not going to be sustainable. It's not going to work. And if it was that easy, everybody would get great results with exercise, and yet they don't. And it's because they are judging things based off of exertion. And that's part of the reasons why it's not sustainable, because you keep going and you keep trying to match that exertion each time. And if you don't hurt yourself, you end up burning out. And what people say is they end up saying, I lost motivation. Well, yeah, because at some point, your body is now trying as hard as it can to get you to not do it because things are breaking down.
I also don't think that it's designed or was created to do for extended periods of time. I don't think that it's something that
that's a good point.
Yeah. I don't think that it was written with the intent of, you should do this all year long, run this type of style of training. Is there exceptions to the rule? Yeah, absolutely. There's always a case where, okay, I could see where someone would apply that for a very specific reason, but that's such a small fraction of the population. Most people that are doing it for overall weight loss or health or also want to build muscle, all the general population.
It's part of the recipe, but it's not the whole
thing. Yeah, no, it's a very small. I mean, there's a reason why the program that we wrote is only, what, 6 weeks long? It's not even that long.
It's the shortest MAPS program.
It's not designed to be something that you follow for, you know, 3-4 months at a time. It's something that you interrupt your training, you get the great benefits of it, and then you move out of it and you move into something more traditional.
Yeah, I guess the biggest reason why I could see HIIT training not being an actual trend is I have yet to see, the vast majority is haphazard programming at best. Mm-hmm. It's literally what you said, Adam. They are people who put out HIIT programs are picking exercises that are hard. And at the most, what they'll consider is be like, oh, we need a back one. We need one for legs. We need one for, but they still don't understand programming. And it's just exercises thrown in there because they're hard and they'll make you sweat.
Yeah.
And it doesn't work that way. And I've told people this before, like I could take your HIIT program that you bought on the internet, that's crap. Mm-hmm. And I could take all the exercises, mix them up in a hat, have you pick five, and there's your new workout. And it's same effectiveness as the other one because the programming's so bad, it doesn't matter what you do. In fact, I could throw all this out and just tell you to do the same thing with hard jumping jacks,
right,
and you would get the same crappy results.
Yeah, or I mean, there's just stuff as trainers we'll see that, you know, you're setting your client up for failure because of, you know, how you stacked the exercises together and what parts of the body you know are going to fatigue and start to give way, and then you stack something else right behind that that's super explosive that's going to, you know, really reveal that the core is fatigued right now, but now we're just going to intensify everything and you don't have the spinal support, which then leaves you susceptible to injury.
Oh, hammer the core and then go right to jump boxes or, you know, something like that, right? Or
start with deadlifts and then, you know, work your way through all these like explosive jumps.
Yeah, here's another thing about the programming is that it's about the time, not about the form. So here's what I mean by that. So with most HIIT programs, it's like do this exercise for 45 seconds, like as hard as you can, right? And then what they'll say is, and this is how they try to remedy, is they'll say, pick a weight that you can get through 45 seconds with or a minute with. So what a person does is they pick a weight that they could survive for 45 seconds. Yeah. And when you watch this person, the only reason why they'll pick a lighter weight to do their exercise is because they had to drop the weight or they couldn't move anymore. The real way to do HIIT training is to do the exercise until your form is no longer perfect. Now you're done. Not until you can't move anymore. That's not when you stop. Again, now why is the reason? Because, you know, why would we do it that way? Because form not only is one of the most important things with all resistance training, because that's what kind of determines what muscles you're developing, how you're developing your muscle recruitment patterns, all that stuff. But, you know, all that plus the risk of injury. Mm-hmm. If you're going fast and hard and your form breaks down a little bit, I cannot explain enough how much of an increase in the risk of injury that produces. Like walking lunges with any exercise, actually, with perfect control and stability is very safe. Any exercise where the form and stability is off becomes dangerous. And depending on the exercise, it goes from like squats, like barbell squats done with really good form and stability and good connection, perfectly safe. You take that and you move it 5 degrees towards bad form, and it went from safe to actually kind of a dangerous exercise. Now this is why you see people who are afraid of squats. Oh, yeah. It hurt my back, or my buddy hurt his knee, or I can't do those anymore. So how they explain going to failure or intensity is so wrong. It should be when your form is no longer perfect. It should not be when you can no longer move or when you're about to throw up. That's the difference. That's a big difference.
Yeah, and it's almost completely the opposite of, you know, what we're trying, like what they're actually like marketing is in terms of like trying to turn off sort of those signals your body's giving you to be able to like endure through this crazy gauntlet of a workout versus being hypersensitive to the what your body's giving you as feedback in order to then be aware of your form breakdown and know that, okay, I'm done with that exercise, I'm gonna move on. Really, the reps are somewhat insignificant. It's more about, you know, trying to ramp up that intensity and definitely get through, you know, a good amount of reps, but they have to be quality. And then I move on and I repeat the quality in the form of, you know, that particular movement I'm trying to do.
Well, there's very little effort put towards modifying this for people, right? In other words, like, the, you know, oh, we know squats are hard and it's a compound movement, or the lunge to the bicep curl to the shoulder press gets the heart rate going. And so it's like that, and this, I'm guilty of this, right? So like, I would write that into every program. It doesn't matter if Susie was a beginner, intermediate, or advanced. I knew that got the heart rate up, so therefore it just made its way into the programming versus understanding that, shit, bicep curls and some light dumbbell shoulder presses for some person could be definitely in a HIIT program. It could be in there and
super
be
intense for some people.
Yeah, challenging enough for that person for them to get their heart rate up, get the benefits of HIIT training without taking the risk and doing something like squats or a movement that they're not even ready to do. And so that was one of the things that I remember when we wrote it that we wanted to take into consideration. It's like, hey, we have to understand that because this is going to appeal to the masses and the people that are just getting started and even for sure the advanced people, we've got to have some way to scale this to where it's like, okay, if you're a beginner, follow this way. If you're someone who's advanced, then you're doing these movements. And we took that into consideration and just, I don't remember ever seeing anybody else do that when I looked at other HIIT
programs.
Well,
no, that's like a marketing nightmare. Like, what do you mean you're giving people all these, like, just be straight. It's one program. Here you go. Yeah, don't confuse people.
Simplify it.
Yeah, and it's like, no, I can't do that with you know, all honesty and integrity. Like, I can't just throw that out there. And I know people want that, but no, there should be, you should have options for beginners, intermediate, and advanced. And HIIT training does have a formula, but that does not mean that it looks the same for you or someone else. The formula essentially is this. It's high-intensity exertion for a short period of time, followed by low intensity movement for a longer period of time, and then you go back to the shorter high intensity movement. So it's not like traditional resistance training where I do a bench press, 12 reps, and then I rest for 2 minutes. It's more like I'm going to a very high intense place with the bench press, and then I move while I'm moving into across the gym to another exercise. I kind of let my heart rate drop a little bit. Now I'm doing another exercise that's complementary. Which, you know, back to the programming, the exercises, it's you're not just looking at each exercise. You're looking at the exercises that follow that exercise, the exercises that precede that exercise, and how they all work together in a workout, and then how those workouts work with the next workout, and so on. All of it makes all of it is something you need to consider. That's what programming is all about. That's why it's so important. If you just throw a bunch of exercises together, you can have exercises that precede or follow an exercise that dramatically increase the risk of injury,
sure,
or dramatically reduce the effectiveness of the programming. Or you could start a workout with exercises that make the second half of the workout far less effective or far more dangerous. Or you cannot prime properly and increase. So there's all these factors that need to be considered.
And an example of that is somebody fatiguing like your core or your low back and then going doing a squatting exercise.
Or deadlifts.
Yeah, exactly. Which is, you see stuff like this where it's just like, oh my God, you're totally fatiguing your core area, which you need to support when you go to do a movement like a squat.
Well, I saw somebody doing, this is no like joke.
Olympic lifts?
No, that's the word. Yeah, I saw someone do kettlebell swings, HIIT style. So the kettlebell swings, HIIT style, barbell squats, deadlifts, jump boxes. Oh. And I'm like, if this person doesn't hurt their back, then they're very lucky to not hurt their back. Now, to the average person, oh, that's an intense workout, right? You're going from those, to an experienced trainer, you know that that's a bad string of exercises in a combination. Probably don't belong, maybe not even in the same workout, or if they do, you have to program them a little differently. So I think HIIT training has got so much allure and so much potential, but like many things in the fitness space, things that actually work get bastardized or watered down or turned into something else because they sell. Mm-hmm. And you know, you can sell things in the fitness space kind of sideways. So you can't blatantly lie. I guess nowadays, if you blatantly lie and you get caught, you get in big trouble. But you can do it in a way to where you can prove it. So I can say burns fat faster than any other form of exercise. Well, I guess I could show studies that That'll show that.
It's like best coffee in the world. You know, when you see those signs. Oh,
world's best coffee.
Yeah, world's best coffee.
According to
a few people told us that. Yeah, okay.
The guy that works there, I'm the one that
determined. Is that what you think? That's what I think of every time I see like claims like that. It's just like, oh yeah, world's best pizza, right?
Or they filled it out online, you know, and then you they got too, a certificate. Huh?
That's that scene in Elf. Remember he walks in the coffee place?
Yeah, yeah. Congratulations.
If you want the thing you love,
you did it. Congratulations. World's best cup of coffee. Great job, everybody.
That's it. But no, it's totally true. They could say all this stuff like, you know, more effective with less time. You don't lose any muscle. You might even build muscle, speeds up. Like, these are all true. But the caveat is must be done properly, must be done appropriately for the right person. If none of those things are met, then what you're doing is a very risky, dangerous form of exercise that will give you terrible results and will result in crazy plateaus. So that's literally, those are the two sides of the story when you come to HIIT training.
Gotta get on the right side.
So consider those things when you're doing your HIIT workouts. They should probably be done for short periods of time, you know, between 4 to 8 weeks at most. And if you're looking for everything to be mapped out and written out for you so you don't have to do all the work yourself, you just like, look, I just want to follow something, and you trust us because you listen to our podcast. We have a program called Maps HIIT, and I believe we are putting it on sale. Doug, what is the sale on Maps HIIT? Is it half off?
It's half off. Its code is HIIT2022, so HIIT 2022, and you can go to mapshit.com. Of course, it's MAPSHIIT.com.
Looks like it says Maps Shit.
Maps Shit.
So MapsHIIT.com and then HIIT2022. All right, so do that and follow that. And also, if you like our information, we have a lot of free stuff too. So if you want more information, you're not sure if you want to get a program or you just want to learn more, go to MapsFree.com. We've compiled lots of guides that can help you with almost any fitness goal. If you want to find us on social media, you can find us on Instagram. Justin is at MindPumpJustin. Adam and I have been shadow banned by Instagram because we get a little controversial. But I think you can still find us. I'm MindPumpSal, and he is MindPumpAdam.